Welcome to today's webinar, The Extended Job Search, Keeping Your Job Search Going Even When You Don't Want To, sponsored by the Georgetown University Alumni Association and Alumni Career Services. Thank you for taking the time to join us today. My name is Emily White, and I am the Assistant Director of Alumni Career Services here at Georgetown, and our presenter today is Marianne Ruggiero, who founded Optima Careers. Today's webinar has been very well received by our alumni community. We have close to 300 registrants, so we're thrilled that so many of you are able to join us. Before we begin, I'd like to share a few housekeeping tips and reminders. Today's presentation is being recorded. You can access the replay of this webinar within 3 to 5 business days on our website. There are two audio options. You can listen via your computer speakers or dial into the conference bridge number provided. Participants are not required to have a headset, but you're welcome to use one. It is important to note if you experience audio difficulties while listening via your computer speakers, this can be caused by having multiple software applications open. Feel free to close some of these applications or simply join us using the conference bridge number provided in your reminder email. Questions are welcome. Please type in your questions in the question area of your GoToWebinar control panel screen. Marianne is planning to answer as many questions as time will allow, and we're going to be dedicating at least 30 minutes of today's presentation towards Q&A, so please begin submitting the questions whenever they come through, and I'll moderate. We will be emailing out a copy of the PowerPoint slides after today's session. If you're having any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me via the chat area if possible. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce our presenter today. As mentioned, Marianne founded Optima Careers after 25 years as a senior human resources executive in New York City and abroad. Her experience covers a range of industries and types of firms, from small entrepreneurial companies to global corporations, from financial services to professional services to fashion, including prominent companies such as American Express, Citigroup, and J.Crew. Well-versed in nurturing promising talent, Marianne has created staffing, development, and coaching programs and accelerated the growth of numerous management teams. She drew on her background to develop the exclusive process she uses with her clients today, helping them generate and articulate information about their values, personality, and work styles to be used in shaping career strategies and planning life goals. Marianne has contributed to the Harvard Business Review, has appeared on CNN Money, and regularly addresses business and education groups. She is a member of the Association of Career Professionals International and has an MBA in organization development from Pace University. Marianne is also one of our most beloved and favorite honorary Hoyas, and I want to thank her in advance for sharing her time and expertise with us today.
Well, thank you, Emily. That's a great introduction. I appreciate the warmth and affection with which I'm an honorary Hoya. But more importantly than all of that stuff about me, the more important thing is to really be focused on all of you who are out there listening to this webinar. If you've been on an extended job search, it's important that you know that you're not alone. I want to give you some statistics, not so much to depress you or be a downer, but to let you know that you may be experiencing a phenomenon that is quite new, and it is not specific and unique to you. The private sector has added some jobs in recent time, but the percentage of unemployed for over 99 weeks has risen. For example, one statistic I'm familiar with is that in March of this past year, the number had risen to 13.5%. from 7.5% a year ago. The majority of new jobs that have been created in this past year really capped out at $20 an hour, so it's not addressing the professional unemployed. There are nearly 1 million people who have just given up trying to find a job. The share of unemployed who found jobs in 53 weeks or more, if you look at the statistics from the Department of Labor, the 2001 there were 1.6% who had found jobs after a year, and in 2009, 5.1%, and last year in 2010, 11%. That statistic may be alarming, but it also is the good news, because you may be thinking that it's easier to find a job when you have a job, and that the longer you are unemployed, the harder it is to get a job. And while there is some truth to that, it is no longer quite the obstacle that it may have been in the past. And in addition, not working is really not an option. So despite the difficulty and despite the obstacles, it's really important to develop strategies and tactics that will keep you in the game and cause you to persist. I've had a number of clients who for various reasons have been on extended job search, and I can tell you that in every case, persistence actually trumps talent. If you give up, you're definitely not going to get a job. But if you do persist and marry that to some strategy, you're likely to be able to create a success formula that would work for you. And the success formula is specific to you. While there's much universal advice, and I'm going to be handing out universal advice to you today, I admit that and I know that, it's important that you take that information, internalize it, and disregard anything that doesn't apply to you, and really leverage what does work for you. So take what resonates. Just because something works for one person doesn't mean it will work for you. You need to know what authentically works for you. While faking it till you make it can work in some situations, it's not the best policy in an extended job search. More effective and more productive is to be yourself, but you do need to be your best self. So committing to excellence in all that you do is a critical, and in fact, you're going to do better than you've ever done before and do it without pay. So while the success formula may be specific to you, I do want to emphasize that I believe there are three factors that need to be part of your formula. The first one is about balance. Have a strategy and be opportunistic. So stay true to your roots, leverage your experience, be strategic in targeting organizations that you want to work for, and despite rejection, stalk until there's a new opening. At the same time, be open to new ideas and be somewhat flexible. We'll talk more about what I mean by that in a few minutes. The second common factor, perhaps to all of you, will be to use the time to develop new capabilities. And the third is to be sure to manage your emotions and your ego. Again, we'll elaborate more specifically on those, but I just wanted to make sure that if you only had 5 minutes today, to remember the mantra, balance, new capabilities, and managing emotions and ego. So in the absence of opportunities, the only alternative, quite frankly, is to be strategic. And what I mean by that is having a vision, analyzing your strengths and weaknesses, your typical SWOT analysis, setting strategic objectives and priorities. Execution then is key to success. And there needs to be a way that you can track your progress, and I'm going to suggest that you have your own KPIs or key performance indicators. Because living through an extended job search is a very personal journey. And it may be easier and more productive if you think of yourself more as a business. With a slow or stale job market, you'll need to be strategic. So for those of you who have moved from job to job in the past because opportunity knocked, this is going to be particularly challenging for you. So that said, let's talk about your strategic plan, and we begin by having a vision. I interviewed several people for this program and found the story of one client to be particularly compelling. While remaining nameless, I certainly have his permission to share the story and to offer his advice. So throughout this presentation, I'll be peppering my information with his perspective. When I met this client, he had already been out of work for some time. In the end, he searched for a job for 2 years. And in our conversation, looking back on that experience, he made the very specific point to say that initially he had a vision for what he wanted. And let me tell you, the vision was big, hairy, and audacious. He wanted to move from small to big, from entrepreneurship to a traditional business. He wanted to get out of one industry and into another. Those are three huge changes to make with one job move. That had a lot to do why it took 2 years. And he will admit that during the process, he felt he had lost sight of this vision and the goal. But in the end, guess what? He went from an entrepreneurial business to a blue chip organization. He moved from the music industry to the more broader media industry. And he went from playing very unique roles that were not replicable to a more traditional role. So now that he has experience in that job, even if he were to decide to leave or to change organizations, he's going out into the market where other companies have that kind of job, and it will facilitate that transition. So hopefully this helps you see that despite difficulties, in the end, finding the right job will not only take great effort right now, and when you are successful, you get that paycheck, but it's also going to improve your longer-term job continuity. And I use the word continuity on purpose. I say there's no such thing as job security, but you can do everything in your power to maintain job continuity. Okay, that said, everyone here is very well educated. Georgetown's done a great job with all of you. My guess is everyone has participated in some kind of SWOT analysis. So on this slide, we're looking at a SWOT analysis performed in part by this client that I'm referring to. And awareness of these factors may help you ride the emotional roller coaster of an extended job search. But it's very important to be clear about the factors you control and the ones you don't. So while the economy may be quite difficult and terrible, you don't control that. But you can control your job search and then catch any waves in the market that have any kind of health or improvement. So when you look at this slide, strength for this individual was he was very flexible and was open not so much to changing where he wanted to work, but he was open to contract work. He picked up a lot of small jobs and contracts. He was able to keep a little bit of cash flow going. He also felt that his transferable skills were critical to his success, and so any skill that he could develop or further leverage, he would. And he made the point to make sure that he was looking good. So he exercised, and quite frankly, looking good and taking care of yourself, particularly if in your 40s and 50s, takes a great deal of time and energy. That investment is still part of your job search. It's not a waste of time. For weaknesses, he felt that not working was a disadvantage. So his decision was he would look as though he were working. He had the energy of somebody working. He was engaging. He had an appointment book. He was on the run. He wasn't always available every minute when people were calling, so that he could create the sense that they saw him as an active individual. If you look at the opportunities, he knew that he had something to offer. He could help organizations catch up on work. He also caught up on a lot of things in his own home, including decluttering. And he spent time learning so that he could put his experience in perspective. He read a lot about history. And he also learned technology, social media, and other things that he could bring to the work environment. And finally, in terms of the threats, he certainly saw the economy as sluggish. Unemployment was steady at the time or decreasing somewhat slightly, but it seemed to be holding. However, there was always increasing competition for the jobs, and he knew that he always had to present himself not only as a strong candidate by himself, but also relative to other people who were available to prospective employers. So when I talk about setting strategic objectives and priorities, I'm talking about having a list of target companies. You need to have industry knowledge and market knowledge and leverage that by focusing on specific companies that you know in your SWOT analysis can use your background and experience. Worry less about whether there's an immediate opening, but play the game for the long-term win. The second strategy is to dominate. Once you've penetrated a company, stay in their line of sight so that when things do change, and they will, you have your ticket punched and people remember you. In this market, hiring managers do not want to pay recruiters for a fee. The only dynamic I'm seeing where recruiters are putting people in is where organizations not only want a candidate who is the right candidate, but they want fast. And they don't have the time to do the networking to get someone in place. In general, this market does not put a premium on speed. In fact, this market's putting the premium on low-risk hires. And by doing it quickly, people are concerned that they might make a mistake. So frankly, in this market, you have an advantage by being a non-fee source candidate. The next most important thing strategically is to remember that you want to enhance your marketability. As every day goes by, you become less fresh. And to avoid growing stale, you definitely want to learn software, whether it's Photoshop or database management programs. Find out what your industry is using. Find out what your job function is using. And get savvy. In addition, depending upon your age, if you're a 20-something, be sure that you demonstrate the skill to be able to work intergenerationally. In the same turn, if you're a 40 or 50-something, be sure that you're peppering your approach to demonstrate that you can also work in an intergenerational conversation. Some of you may be thinking about starting over. So when you look at strategic objectives and priorities, you're saying, okay, I get the networking, I get the developing capabilities and skills, And I understand that I have to establish my offering and differentiate myself relative to the competition. But let's say you've played those strategies and it's 6 months or 9 months later. Should you be thinking about starting over? That depends upon your SWOT. If you have been in a job, for example, I would say traders are particularly vulnerable. Or if you were on the exchange floor, even more vulnerable, where there had been 500, then there were 200, now there are 100, and one day we may have no one left on the trading floor. If you're in that situation and the jobs are going away, then it may be worth the 2 or 3 years to start over. But remember, when you start over, you also begin at the bottom of the pay scale. So you have to recognize that you're not going to get the same six-figure number in a job where you're starting over. Now, let's say you've got your strategy, and now you're in execution mode, and you have to execute on your priorities. Many clients ask me, how should I allocate my time? Here's what I tell them. First, don't spend time posting for jobs that clearly are not the right level or role for your experience. The I could do that strategy is a dead-end strategy. The second element I ask them to take into consideration is if you were working and you were working 40 or more hours a week, that would be appropriate to a job. If you're investing less than 20 hours a week, you're not going to make progress. You'll not develop sufficient momentum, and you're likely not to really have your head in the game. On the other hand, if you're spending 40 hours or more, you may be overkill, and that rate of production may or may not really make anything happen any sooner. So I would suggest that if you're doing your 25 to 30 some hours, you're probably in the right zone. And that difference between 30 and 40 could be spending 2 hours a day in the gym. Finally, how much time should you be spend on the computer? For me, computer time should be less spent in terms of posting, which you'll see on the slide, maybe up to 10%, but time spent researching, identifying the kinds of companies that would want someone like yourself, identifying the players at that company, figuring out how to get in the door, getting introductions. That is the way you want to be spending your time. So reading the paper, staying abreast of your field, all of that is relevant and important to do, but I would suggest that the proportion of time might be the 25 to 35% on research, 10 to 15% on learning, networking 50 to 60%, and posting only up to 10%. But definitely live your life, exercise, go out, and you may be laughing when you see declutter. I have to say, the client that I talked about at the beginning mentioned to me that his mother had suggested that he declutter as a way to begin to exercise some of the demons and also to kind of vent a little bit and work out some of his frustration and anger. So he started getting rid of things. Unfortunately, by the end of his search, he had gotten rid of about 75% of everything he owned, and he does admit he may have gone a little bit too far. But that cleansing process up to a point is often a very good way to manage, because you're opening up those pathways somehow physically, and at the same time you may be decluttering your mind and letting go of some of your myths and letting go of some of your ideals and opening up the pathway to what may more pragmatically be available to you. So now, one of the key things I found with clients also is that it's very frustrating to say, you know, my goal is to find a job, and it's very hard to know if you're making progress, so it's kind of an all or nothing game. So I would like to give you some ideas about how you could take your business, the analogy we were working with, and set up some key performance indicators so that you can make your progress visible. So, for example, today jobs are generally around 4 to 5 degrees of separation. Before the recession, I would have said it was 3 or 4 degrees. So you need to crash through that 4 degrees of separation quitting point. So if in your search you don't get a job immediately through contacts that you absolutely know, those 1 and 2 degrees of separation people, if that wave of contact hasn't gotten you anywhere, then you will need to network and go to the 4 or 5 degrees of separation. So start marking those relationships in your networking, because you'll begin to realize that the more bleak it looks, but you're hitting 4 and 5 degrees, I'm telling you, you're getting much closer to getting that job. Another way to think of it is that count the number of doors you get into, what percentage of the doors that you get into are on your target list, what's the number of contacts that you've developed in a given company, get more than one or two, what's the number of relationships that you've added to your active network so that even when you do get a job, these are going to be people who will make your network more robust and more productive. How many times do you make it onto a slate? How many times are you getting to get to the semifinals so that you can get your offer and get the right job? So I hope that this way of tracking your time will help you manage the process and feel more optimistic as you get deeper into the process. So all of that said, I've been addressing really the doing part of the job search, and there are three really elements to be balancing. Having the vision, having a plan, and executing the plan is critical. But I don't want to ignore or undervalue the impact of two other aspects of the search, and that's the thinking and the feeling part. Thinking is important, staying relevant, focusing on your own productivity. You should, in fact, be busier than ever, not have lots of free time. When you think about the thinking, be honest with yourself and everyone else. Focus on what you have to offer. While hiring managers are taking the short view, you need to take the long view. So maybe the job is somewhat less attractive than you would like it to be, but it has the potential for greater interest down the road. Keep in mind, 50% of senior hires don't work out. So if the job was filled a year ago, go back and find out what happened. Stay in touch. Don't let your ego get in the way of possibly seeking a second chance. And stay relevant. So if you look at news, interpret the news. If you're interested in advertising, track who is pitching new business and get yourself in the door before they've won it or lost it so that they know that if they're successful, you're ready to go once they get that business and can add a job. All right, so we've covered the thinking part. Now we're into the feeling part. And I want to first make sure everybody knows very clearly, I am not a therapist, I am not a shrink, so this is not really my territory. But it would be wrong to avoid the subject and to not mention that managing your emotional stuff is really critical to dealing with an extended job search. So you may feel rejected. What do? Stay focused on the end goal and have your vision in mind. If you believe you'll work again, you will. And quite frankly, delusions are a key characteristic of successful people. So this is the time, if you've ever been delusional, to put it on the table and keep it. To cope with depression, frankly, if you feel depressed, you can't get out of bed in the morning, then get help. You really want to see a therapist. This is no time to be proudful. And get the help that you may need. A career consultant or a doctor can make a reference. And if you're angry, I would expect you would be, go to the gym. Take control of your closets and your space, find safe and healthy ways to exercise those demons. So these are all legitimate feelings, and you may be going down this list and saying, yep, that's me. That's fine. Acknowledging them and then working out strategies to overcome them is the way to go so that your thinking, feeling, and doing can all merge together in a positive way. If you're positive and you think you can get a job, you will get a job. Now, I'm sure everybody has their own unique experience of the extended job search, or maybe you're sitting there and fearful of facing one. So while I'm more qualified on the thinking and the doing part, I'm certainly open for comments, or if you want to say something about the feeling part, don't hesitate, because I'm sure someone else feels that way too. But why don't we open it up now for questions? I'd love to hear from you and find out what's on your mind.
Thank you so much, Marianne. I just want to remind everyone on the line that you can submit your questions through the question area of your GoToWebinar control panel screen, and we'll answer as many as time will allow. Marianne, we've gotten one question related to if you could expand a little bit more on the concept of dominating your space.
Okay. What I mean by that is in your marketing plan for your job search, you likely have your goal. You likely have your target industry. And you may or should have 30 to 50 companies or organizations that you think would best qualify as organizations that could leverage your strengths and where you think there would be the kinds of opportunities where you can make a contribution. So you take this target list, and let's say Deutsche Bank and JP Morgan Chase and Goldman and Barclays are on your list. Then you do everything you can to do two things. One is identify and create as many contacts within that organization. And secondly, find ways to stay in touch with those people over an extended period of time. It's essentially, to put it in a not so nice word, stalking. But I thought it sounded more strategic to call it dominate.
Great. That's a great response. Marianne, I know that we're not specifically covering resumes, and we actually do have a webinar that Marianne's done that's fabulous on resumes that you can find on our archive section of our webinars online. But we had a great question. Do you have a quick tip on how to overcome a long gap of not working at the top of someone's resume?
Addressing a gap in employment. I am hesitant without, I would say my general rule, if I knew the specifics, maybe I might comment somewhat differently, but in general, I would say that's not really the place to account for a gap in employment. The gap in employment would more typically be addressed in the cover letter or in the email addressing it saying, here's where I took time out for family leave, or here's where I had taken a sabbatical for whatever reason. If it's right in the middle and it's a missing 1 year or a missing 2 years, I think you could actually leave that up to people's imagination. They're less likely to think it was because you were a hostage in Iran, and more likely think that either you were unemployed and aren't playing the game of pretending that you were a consultant, and so they would respect you for that. Or if all things are attractive in your resume with that exception, you'll get a telephone interview and a pre-screening with that question, can you please explain your gap in employment?
Thank you. Related to your response to the question before, do you have a good strategy on developing that list of targeted organizations? Do you tend to look with Google searches, association publications? Do you have a tip with that?
A great question. I have found in working with clients, the greatest weakness in most job searchers is the ability to do career research. And you need to kind of put your old collegiate hat on and remember your research skills from college. All of those things that you said are the ways to go. If I'm looking at the advertising business, then I'm going to look at Ad Age and make that my home page. I'm going to start tracking who's getting new business, who's losing business, and who's moving where. I'm going to look for lists. You may have to pay $30 and buy a list from Amazon for the Cranes publication or for the Business Week publication. I think spending up to $50 on information is reasonable. Most information is free. And in very few industries, you need to spend a lot of money. Although I would say in the hedge fund business, I have had clients that have had to buy research and spend $100 or $200 to get a book or to get a list. But you're really pulling together the information online. I'll give another example of an attorney looking to make a transition from a law firm to a general counsel position. Readily and easily available is the Fortune 500. Of those which are in the New York metropolitan area. For those, you can go online and you can read the websites and generally get the name of the CEO. You may need, however, to then go into the 10K report to identify the general counsel. If you study and examine the investor relations portion of the website and the press portion of the website, you may find information where the general counsel is quoted, or where there is a comment about some outstanding legal matter, and again, that might be a place to find it. So in this case, this individual, within 4 or 5 hours, was able to put together a list of the 20 or 30 relevant companies in the New York area, and we identified not only the general counsel in those positions, but where the position was open. And because of the 10K report and other publications, we were able to identify the age of most incumbents, which then allowed us to say, okay, they're working full-time as a partner in a law firm, need to run a very efficient campaign. of the 30 companies, we were able to shortlist it to 5, where A, the entire senior management team was male, so perhaps they would welcome the resume and the contact of a female lawyer. 2, where there were openings or interim executives in the general counsel position. And 3, where the general counsel was 60 or older, where we thought perhaps at that point the company and the board might be willing to consider hiring in a potential successor, giving them runway to establish themselves and their credibility and earn the right to be the successor. And then we took those 5 to 10 firms and stalked them. I hope that gives kind of the general guideline about research, but also gives you a specific way kind of how to narrow in and bridge it from research to opening.
Yes, thank you. One comment before we move on to the other questions. We have an audience member that has suggested that in his resume, when addressing the gap of unemployment, he has defined it as a period of professional self-education, and that has worked for him in the past. So just a comment to pass along to the group.
Great.
Marianne, we have a really interesting question that I think a lot of people on the line would be able to relate to. Someone posed the thought and question that they find themselves feeling uncomfortable recontacting people that they might have first contacted six months ago. Mm-hmm. They're trying not to feel embarrassed and to develop an upbeat elevator speech on what they've been up to and why they're checking in again on the status of any potential employment opportunities.
Okay, well, that staying in touch story. The first piece of that is remember that when you start to engage with people that you want to stay on top of that relationship in a way that is appropriate to the level of contact and the nature of it. And remember that while you may feel that you have an empty rice bowl, it's not really empty, perhaps half full. So you want to give as well as get and demonstrate that you're a giver. Even if you simply say something such as, well, it's been some time since we've been in touch, I've thought of you and have kept what you said to me about blah, blah, blah in mind. And that has been great advice, so I thank you again for that. In addition, I wanted to keep you up to date about what I'm doing while I remain available. I have made progress in penetrating this or in identifying 2 or 3 new target companies. And in that spirit, might you know anyone in any of these companies? So you get your ask out, and then you close with, it's been very affirming for you to be a supporter throughout this process. I hope you know that if there's anything I can do for you, please ask. So let them know that you understand that you kind of owe them and that this is a reciprocal relationship. It's just that at the moment you're on the taking side, not the giving side. Secondly, you'll be amazed at how much you have to offer. You might be talking with someone, you know that their partner is a big foodie, and you recently had the experience of going to a new restaurant, or you've been reading Time Out, or you know somebody who went to a great restaurant, then you don't have to make all of your gives professional. So you can also say in an email to someone, oh, by the way, I know that you enjoy Chinese food, and as it happens, I heard of this great recommendation, so it might be something you want to try. So you want to think of ways to give as well as to get. And finally, professionally, you're spending more time in the market. People who are in jobs are fighting to keep those jobs and have less time often to stay on top of big news. Even if you may think they know that news, the fact that you thought to give it to them, maybe, I know that you're really busy, I was reading Boris Groysberg's Chasing Stars to learn more about the industry and think more about how to leverage my background in equity research. And I have to tell you, it's one of the greatest business books I've ever read. I'm attaching a one-page summary, Cliff Notes, so that if you'd like to, you can read the one-page version instead of the 800-page version. It really is a terrific book, and I hope you enjoyed reading my summary. So create things that you can give to people so that they know you want to give. That makes them want to stay in touch with you and to continue to support you.
That's a great response. Thanks, Marianne. Another question we have on the matter of choosing job opportunities that are realistic. What are your thoughts about taking jobs that are lateral moves and or lower paid? How do you spin that if the job market gets better, you might want to leave for a higher paying job?
Okay, well, there are lots of elements in that one. So if I don't hit on all three issues, Emily, remind me. One is, what about a lateral job? A lateral opportunity is a great opportunity because presumably you might be doing what you've always done, but doing it in a new or different context, or doing it in an environment and in an economy that is somewhat different than where you've done it before. So in fact, there are qualifying and enhancing elements to that lateral move. So if you, again, put the ego aside and forget title for a moment and forget the fact that maybe you've been doing this for a long time, if you find the freshness in it, they'll also see you as a more fresh candidate. Often people don't want to hire people for laterals or for jobs that are a bit smaller than what someone's done before because they, for that very reason, they're afraid that you're going to be bored on the job, feel stuck, and at the moment you can, you'll immediately bolt. That makes you a not very good candidate, even for a lateral or a smaller job. So it serves you and the organization to find the beauty in whatever that lateral or somewhat smaller job is. Then the issue of pay is somewhat different. If someone says to me that they're willing to take a pay cut and they're willing to take half of what they made, I would be suspect and not believe them. Or if I did that, I would pretty much assume that as soon as you can, you're going to leave. So if you're talking about a job where you're taking that kind of a pay cut, then I think it might even be hard for you to even get that job. But assuming that you did, I think they're being opportunistic, and they figure if they can't move you along and pay you better, yeah, you'll bolt, and that's okay. Maybe that's the deal. On the other hand, let's say you've been a vice president of finance or you've been a CFO and the company decides to bring somebody in over you and they now offer you the VP of finance job and they want to shave your pay by 25% but are willing to keep you in the organization because of your history and because of the way you've conducted yourself. Then that may be a situation where you take that, but you might ask and say, I can accept somewhat of a reduction in pay because of my loyalty to the organization. I really want to work here, and I'll learn something from this new guy or this new woman. But is there an opportunity for me to make up some of the difference, if not all, in my bonus or in some kind of long-term incentive? So look more broadly at the income potential and go beyond base and look at bonus and long-term. Did I answer all of those questions?
Yes, thank you so much.
Good.
Marianne, once you get the name of the top employees as targeted organizations, how do you approach getting interviews or getting your foot in the door? The person that's answering this question has done a ton of informational interviews, and I'm wondering if they should keep asking for those or they should take a different approach.
Well, if you're getting in the door initially for an information interview, that's good for you, by the way. First of all, congratulations. You know, KPI number one or two, you're in the door. Now you want to convert that person from the information stage to the candidacy stage. So you can go back to the same people and say, having gathered information now and done my research in the market, I have clarified where I think the organizational fit will be greatest and where I think I can make the most contribution. In that regard, I would very much like to let you know that that my bottom line is that I would very much like to be sure that I'm in your database and could be considered for positions when they come up. May I ask you, based upon our meeting, do you need to see me again to qualify me, or would you be willing to tell me if you've got me in your information database so that when openings come up, you'll be able to retrieve my resume? So you begin to create the conversation to convert them to candidate status. The second thing is, if you're in the door, again, which is great, you could tell them, having done your research, you're now very even more interested in their organization and in the role that you would play there. Would they be willing to let you meet additional people in the hope that if or when they had an opening, they would have already pre-qualified you and would save some time in filling their positions? You always want to make sure that, I know it's, right now it's painful, it's all about you, but to the extent that you can convert every conversation to make it all about them, you're dramatically increasing your chances of getting a job.
Great, thank you. An interesting question, someone on the line, congrats to them, that graduated 4 months ago with their master's in public policy and has thus far been getting 3 to 4 job interviews a month, but has always ended up coming out as the number 2 or number 3 when it comes to final choices.
Oh.
Is this good momentum, or should they be worried about getting more interviews?
No, it's great momentum. You know, again, your KPI, you're getting in the door and you're getting on, you're finding jobs and you're getting on the slate. It means your resume is fine. It means your networking in is fine. It means your research is fine because you're finding openings. You're doing a lot of things well. What you may not be doing so well to get from candidate to semifinalist or finalist is the weakness in your marketing may be the extent to which you are able to articulate your competitive advantage. Because now you're in. I think you qualify. You're one of the candidates. Now the question isn't so much about, it may not be about fit because you've made the slate. It's probably not about your strengths. They know that you can do the job. Now it's why should they hire you compared to the other 2 or 3 people that they've met? And how is your competitive advantage an advantage to them and to that job? So I would focus more on that aspect of your marketing.
Thank you. We have a question related to ageism. Do you have any tips on how to best deal with potential ageism that might occur during a telephone or in-person interview?
Yes, I would say you're right, it exists. Sometimes ageism and a bias around age is code for you don't really want this job. You've been doing it for 30 years. It's the same job you've been doing. You're going to be bored. We want somebody who thinks it's fascinating. We want somebody who's still interested, somebody who's going to be passionate for it. Even if it's a job that you can't have passion for, they want to think that their jobs are so attractive that somebody will have passion for it. So you have to sound engaged, interested, or something unique or special about their situation. You have to articulate for them where you see the challenge and why it tempts you and engages your interest. When you're doing a screening interview on the phone, I often recommend, for example, that you get up. They can't see you, I hope. So when you're on the phone, stand up and walk around the room while you're speaking on your phone because it will make you come across more energized and more active. And thirdly, I would say often ageism in person, they're equating this with how you look. So again, if you are overweight or if you are carrying around a style and a hairdo or an approach that looks like it came out of 1970 or 80 and you haven't updated yourself in any professional way, then they might be looking at you and say, oh, they're stuck in time. You know, they got to get rid of those little rounded curly cues in their hair that's appropriate for somebody in their 20s, but not for somebody in their 50s, or don't they know enough that they shouldn't be wearing those kinds of heels, or that suit looks like it's 20 years old, that all of those things send cues that you are not with the times. I even suggest to clients that they seriously consider the font on their resume, to use something a little bit more contemporary than New Times Roman, so that you look modern and clean and contemporary.
Really interesting feedback. Thank you, Marianne.
Oh, and just one other thing. In case we have people in the audience who are in their early 60s, you know, if you're 61 and you're on an extended job search and it goes to 62, now they're thinking you're going to retire at 65. Why hire somebody who's only going to be here for 2 or 3 years? When you get as far as in the door and you're talking seriously about the job, they may ask, what are your plans for retirement? In general, when the market looks at your resume, they care about what you've done for the last 5 years. So I think the 5-year frame may be a good formula to follow. And you could say something like, I plan on continuing to work for some time. And if you would like a commitment from me to say that I would be willing to commit to 5 years, then I would be prepared to do that. What kind of time frame do you have in mind? That way they know that they won't have to fire you because you refuse to retire and you're going to be there till 75. On the other hand, they're going to get some runway out of you so that the organization has a chance to take you in, adopt and adapt to you, and help you become productive, and then get their mileage out of you for a couple of years before you take off.
That's great. Thank you. I think it was maybe one question earlier, we had talked about competitive advantage. Someone on the line wants to know if you can talk more about how to discover your competitive advantage and what are new ways to look at that.
Yes, this is the exercise I give my clients, at least on the first round, to get that information. You're asking yourself, what is unique, special, or different about you compared to others with similar experience and background? And when you ask that question in that way, you have to scratch below the surface. So it can't be traits like hardworking, energetic, smart. Let's assume for a moment that all the other candidates are that way too, because that's the kind of person they've been looking for. So you really have to dig down deep. The exercise that I suggest to clients is that they contact 5 people who have worked with them and who have worked with other people in a similar role. So if I want to ask this question about my head of human resources, I will go to other people who have hired and managed HR people and said, I've worked for you for X number of years. You've had several HR people work for you for many years. What was different or unique or special about the way I operated compared to others? Ask them the question, give them time to answer it, and ask them to send it to you in a written form, via email or in a note, so that you can look at the responses of at least 5 people. There will be themes and patterns to the responses that you get back, and that will begin to inform your competitive advantage.
That's great. Thank you. Interesting question. How does one handle requests for salary requirements without pricing yourself out of the market?
Well, you have the answer in your question. It's all about the market. So you should have data points. If someone says, how much do you want, and you know what you need and what you think you can get, everybody tells you never be the first person to put the number on the table. What you can do is say, having been in the market and talked to any number of companies and individuals in the field, my understanding of the market is that the range for this job might be, and you give a range. Regardless of what you've ever made, you would expect to get paid the going rate for that position. So if the range is 100 to 150, the hiring rate, the going rate, is probably midpoint. So just make sure, ask them if their data points and the survey information that they've collected at their end would echo the same information that you're hearing in the market.
We've talked a little earlier about how to address the unemployment gap on your resume. Someone has a specific question to get your opinion on. Is playing the game, as you put it, of being a consultant during your unemployment period a losing strategy or a winning?
If it's real and you actually have clients or assignments that you can speak to, then it's absolutely fine to do because it's real. What it's not a good idea is to put it down and then have some clever recruiter or hiring manager say, so tell me about 3 or 4 of your clients and what you've done for them in the last 6 months. You know, if you only have one, you're going to be embarrassed. So I would say if it's real, it's a good idea, and that's what I mean about being flexible. If you can pull together some assignments or temporary jobs, then you can put that as your place saver to cover the gap and say have, you know, delivered on a number of assignments in this industry with companies like and solving problems including blah, blah, blah. And you have a little place saver on your resume for it. But I've had clients bring me, had one individual bring me a resume, claim to have done all kinds of, to have this thing on their resume, it sounded pretty good. When I gave them what I considered a typical interview and questioned that experience, well, it turned out it was really half the time and in the end they did something, but there was no real result. It actually created more of a problem than it was worth.
Thank you. One really great question we've been asked is, Marianne, what is the best way to approach companies that you have applied to and they have not sent a rejection or any correspondence to you, but it's been quite some time since you've applied for a position?
Well, if you've applied online, then you may or may not ever hear, and they're not waiting for you to follow up, and I'm not sure who you would follow up with. You really haven't penetrated the company by simply applying. When I talk about dominating a space, it's identifying some names of people, finding out who is the recruiter. For example, with Georgetown, what you might do is, if you're after a company that continues or has recruited on campus, they probably have a recruiter for campus recruitment assigned to Georgetown. Well, you could find out who that person is, likely through your career services. Emily, you can correct me if I'm wrong. And they may give you the name of the recruiter from JP Morgan Chase, who is responsible for coming on campus. And you contact that person and say, I know that your company is interested in Georgetown graduates. As an alum, I'd be very interested in your company as well. Would you be able to direct me to the appropriate person who would do senior recruiting? So you network with them. You don't need to see them. You don't need to spend a lot of time with them, but they'll give you a name because they're interested in goodwill and in a good relationship with Georgetown. So you have to penetrate and get to people. Simply applying online means you've gone into some data dump, and unless you have the right keywords on your resume, you may never have gotten into their database, in which case they're not going to respond. If you've met people and you've been a candidate and they've never gotten back to you, that's a whole different problem.
We have a follow-up question related to salary requirements, and this might be something that's a little too specific for us to answer, but Marianne, do you know of any tools besides Googling online, looking into association publications, the best way to find out what a standard position pays?
Recruiters.
Okay.
Yeah. Go to the, if you have a contact or a friend at a search firm, or if you know people who you've used in the past who are recruiters, they're filling these jobs and they're on top of the market and they can probably help you price a job.
If someone on the line that must be currently employed and wants to know if they are employed but are looking to move into a more relevant and successful position at a target, at a competitor company, do you have any suggestions on how to apply and get known within the industry without having any conflicts of interest?
That's a pretty tricky question, probably is more specific than I would know how to answer. In general, the traditional way probably, as I've said, everyone is, you know, 6 degrees of separation from Kevin Bacon. There may be a third party who has excellent ties to that organization as well as to you, who might be able to help broker some introductions of a social nature, so that it's not as blatant and obvious to your current employer and would not put you in any jeopardy relative to any kind of conflict of interest or collusion. So you may have to look at the network and say, in addition to your operational contacts in terms of getting the job done, who are your social contacts that could also put you together with people in that organization for the initial entree.
Great, thank you. We have someone who's posing an interesting question related to out-of-state hiring. Marianne, how do you make yourself more appealing as an out-of-state hire in a day and age when companies aren't interested in offering relocation packages or even considering or interviewing out-of-state clients?
Well, they're absolutely right, because a key word could very well be your zip code. So you're right to be concerned. My recommendation to my clients is to put on your resume an address so that you also have some stake in that geographic area already, and they will inquire at least and contact you to find out if they can interpret that to mean you would not require relocation, in which case you would become a candidate. So let's say you're thinking that you want to move to Santa Fe, but you can't move until you have a job. Make your fam tour to Santa Fe, or find a friend in Santa Fe, or find an alumni in Santa Fe who would let you put on your resume, temporary address, Santa Fe. That way, they say, he's got two addresses on this. Well, it's worth a call. Let's see what the story is. A resume just gets you in the door. It doesn't get you in the job. It doesn't get you the job, but at least you'll get a conversation, and they'll say, we noticed you had a temporary address in Santa Fe. Do you have family here? Is this where you would live if you moved here? Can you tell us more about this address and your situation?
Thank you. With all the different information to keep track of in a job search, contacts, who you followed up with, what you're waiting to hear back from, and what companies you're looking for, et cetera, do you have any recommendations, or have you worked with any clients that have found a successful way to organize all of this information?
No. Only those who are compulsively well organized have a system that works for them. I would say, in general, people are working off of spreadsheets, and they work in Excel so that they can sort by company or resort by a date column or resort by a name, and they simply resort and kind of go back and forth, maintaining a worksheet around their target companies, and then separating out the targeting from the random acts of networking opportunistically, which still may be useful and leverageable, but they kind of separate out the strategic from the opportunistic.
Thank you. We have time for maybe one or two more questions, because I want to make sure we close up today with some last-minute information. Marianne, in terms of managing emotions, what advice would you give to a candidate in an extended job search who has started to focus more on the length of time they have been unemployed rather than what they have to offer?
Well, inherent in that is what you need to do differently is definitely focus more on where you want to go and the vision of what you want to be doing. Look forward, don't look back. So kind of stop counting the months and stop counting the days away from, and really be targeting, you know, what do you think you can get accomplished in the next 2 weeks? What can you get accomplished in the next month? Because if you're a business and you're in a turnaround, you can't spend your time thinking about all the reasons why everything went wrong. What you can do is be decisive, stay focused, and slog your way through the difficulties, knowing that there will be a brighter day. In the same way, you can't fix everything in a career in one job move. You know, what's the one thing you can accomplish and do well to move the ball down the field? If you move the ball down the field by an inch every week, in 12 weeks you'll have moved it a foot, and in more time, a yard, and eventually you'll get across the finish line. In my recommended readings, and I think that might be a slide, I often think that reading and getting some inspiration, kind of developing that delusional can-do attitude without becoming Pollyanna or crazy. There's a particularly good book that a client of mine recommended, and I can recommend it as well, called Mojo, How to Get It, How to Keep It, and How to Get It Back If You Lose It, by Marshall Goldsmith. He's been around a long time, and it's a fun book. The title alone will make you smile. And I've also had recommended a book by David Burns called Feeling Good. I almost always recommend Boris Groysberg's 5 Ways to Bungle a Job Change. It's always entertaining. More thoughtful and even better is his book called Chasing Stars. And anything about optimism, as you guys all may know, Martin Seligman is the father or the founder of positive psychology. And his book on learned optimism, thinking of resiliency as a skill as opposed to an inherent trait, he helps people identify what their set point is in terms of their pessimism or optimism, and then provides ideas and ways of looking at the world and adjusting your talk tape to yourself so that you can build up your capacity for resiliency.
That's a perfect segue into our wrap up and transition, Marianne. I'm right now on the reading recommendation slide, so I'm going to turn it over to you if you want to close out, and then I'll wrap things up with some last minute housekeeping reminders for everyone.
Okay, great. Well, then with that, I would just say, kind of in closing, put yourself back in the driver's seat on that bus. Be decisive, set your strategy, know where you're going, stay focused, though be flexible, but not to the point where you're going in multiple directions at multiple times. Be persistent, be thoughtful, make your weakness a strength. So those of you who haven't done a job for 2 years or more, you know what, the people who have been doing that job for 2 years are now burnt out. You can say, well, I may have been out for over a year. Guess what? I come fresh. I come passionate. I understand how valuable it is to have a job, and I would embrace this job so much more powerfully than someone who's going from job to job. And finally, be proud. Use your time productively and know that you're working for yourself, and who wouldn't you work hardest for? So I thank everybody for all your attention. I always admire people who can stick in there for the whole hour. And I appreciate the platform and shared some of my clients' experiences with you, and hope that it certainly helps and supports at least, and perhaps inspire and motivate at best. So thank you very much for having me.
Thank you so much, Marianne. As always, this was spot on and provided a lot of concrete takeaways that everyone can immediately implement. We've already gotten a couple of great comments of folks saying this has been fantastic, and they want to thank you for your time and encouragement. I also want to remind everyone we'll be sending a follow-up email right after this webinar ends with a copy of the presentation slides, details on how to access the archive recording of this webinar in case you want to share it with any of your friends or listen to it again. It will be on our website within 3 to 5 business days. And also, we'd love for you, if you're interested, to subscribe to Optimal Thoughts, which is Marianne's monthly e-newsletter. It's one of our office's favorites out of all of our presenters. And we'll include a link on how to sign up for that newsletter directly in the follow-up email, or you can do so right now on the PowerPoint slide that's up. Marianne, I want to thank you so much again for sharing your time and expertise, and I want to thank everyone on the line for joining us. And we hope you'll join us for other webinars we have upcoming in the next few weeks, and we hope that everyone has a great day. Thank you.
Thank you. Goodbye, everybody.